be nice to nerds. Chances are you'll end up working for one. A popular quote by Bill Gates as he articulates the prestige that can come with the term nerd. However, it also has some very negative stereotypes that go along with it as well. For example, sometimes people think of it as antisocial, lacking athletic ability, or even being a recluse, like living in your mother's basement until you're 40. I would like to talk a little bit about those two beliefs, see if we can come to a marriage between them as we contrast them as we go. On my talk today, I would like to define nerd, give a working definition of what it is for a nerd for my talk today. I would also like to address some of those negative stereotypes and potentially why they are that way. I would like to talk about what draws people to the culture that is the nerd culture. And then finally, I would like to share some of my personal things that I enjoy about nerd culture. When you look up dictionary.com's definition, you see lots of negative words. I see socially awkward, boring, unstylish, single-minded, obsessed, non-social, almost entirely negative words defining nerd. The only positive one is intelligent. It actually gets worse if you just type it into Google. A foolish or a contemptible person lacking social skills or boringly studious. We're contemptible. I consider myself to be a nerd. I've never considered myself contemptible. I would like to give a working definition for the remainder of my talk, wherein I'm going to say a person is a nerd if they have an interest in any number, and probably multiple, of these topics. East Asian media like anime, role-playing, trading card games, comics, fantasy, sci-fi, math, science, technology, or engineering. I would kind of like to make a differentiation between the two types of nerds that we're looking at here, and I think it's why the term nerd has different terms. The first few seem to be fantastical in nature, whereas the last few seem to be more in the STEM field. I would say Bill Gates specifically is referring to the last ones. On my talk today, I would like to talk about the first ones, the ones that get negative stereotypes based around them. As we're moving forward, some of the negative stereotypes were addressed in research by Jessica McCain, Brittany Gentile, and W. Keith Campbell. They looked at what engages geeks in culture, and I would say they're using geek the same way I'm using nerd in this talk. Their first talk that they looked at was the hypothesis called the Great Fantasy Migration. This is the belief that people are unhappy with what's going on in their lives, and they're trying to escape it. It's a form of escapism where the people think highly of themselves, cannot find prestige in what they're doing, so they go elsewhere to find that interaction and that prestige and that clout. When they're looking at this stereotype, this is the intelligent and socially awkward group. Because they can't find it elsewhere, they go here instead. The second one is the belongingness hypothesis. With the belongingness hypothesis, they say these people were already probably socially awkward, but because all people need relationships and interaction, they group together and then they interact in their own way. This one says they're probably not grouping around the nerdism, like the topics, but around the fact that they are all socially awkward and then they do them together. They're likely introducing them to and about each other. And then the last one is the desire for engagement. With the desire for engagement hypothesis, they say there's a really good chance that these people like to do. A lot of popular media is passively received. When you sit down on a Sunday afternoon to watch the football game, you are not actively involved. You are engaged, sure, but you're not active, you are passively receiving. And that's that way with the news or lots of other forms. This theory says these people like to do things. When you think of things that are nerdy, playing card games, playing video games, playing board games, role-playing, they have the term play. It's something you actively do. They don't like the passive nature of what everyone else does, just sitting around talking about the news, so they want to do something actively. When they're looking at this type of the term nerd with these types of groups of people, they think it was probably popularized by the 1970s show Happy Days. They used it a lot there, but Hollywood has lots of other interactions as well, like Revenge of the Nerds or Big Bang Theory. When you think of those ones, they're the protagonists in a positive light, but the stereotype, awkward, socially inept, definitely not athletic, difficulty interacting with people, where the normal person in the room is almost funny in how they interact with the nerds. These are probably where a lot of the negative stereotypes are coming from. There's also negative stereotypes about the people that are nerds being reclusive, the living in their mother's basement. This is kind of interacted with by the book, The Boy Crisis by John Gray and William Farrell. In the book, they talk about a lot of reasons why boys do not grow into what we want to have as the typical male role model. Things that in the current landscape, that's not happening. I listened to a podcast recently by them, and they compared two things: playing video games and getting involved in romantic relationships, and how this type of group, this nerd group, probably being socially inept, does not interact romantically with people. Why not? Here they said there's probably what's called a positive feedback loop, two things that loop around each other and create an effect. You have a boy who likes to play video games. They're enjoying playing video games. It's a very traditional thing for young males to do. However, they reach out and try and interact in a romantic relationship, unsuccessfully. Being that for any number of reasons, it might not work out, and that comes with lots of negative feelings and negative emotions. With those negative feelings and emotions, they return to what they know: video games. They go back and they say, that was horrible, and they reclude themselves for a short time. However, in that short time, they've gotten no more socially adept. They've gotten no more experience. In the event that they try and go back again, they're no more likely to succeed, likely to fail again. This loop keeps happening until they no longer try, and when they do, they fail miserably. This positive feedback loop saying, video games, try it, didn't work, go back to this, because this one never failed them. Now, notice about all of these things, there was something desirable about the culture that kept them there. Let's take a quick look at what is drawing people to the culture and why they enjoy it. The first thing is that it has a very low floor and a high ceiling. This is referring to resources. You do not need to invest very much time, effort, or money in nerd culture. You buy the video game and you're good to go. You sit down with friends with the board game and you play. You meet up with your friends, maybe one of them supplies the card game and you can just learn the rules. Within 1 hour, you can learn the rules of a popular trading card game like Pokemon, Yu-Gi-Oh, or Magic the Gathering. They hand you one, you play. Very low ceiling, requires no education to enter. That was the great fantasy migration. Right? They couldn't do whatever they wanted to do because they didn't have the prestige and the education, so they went here. But that's a good thing. The fact that it is available for all people to try it. The high ceiling is also a good thing. It lets people who want to invest those resources continue to get better at whatever topic they are doing. You see professional video gamers now. The last Fortnite champion won over $1 million for winning it. There's a very high ceiling. With this low floor, letting anybody enter all the way to a high ceiling, everybody is welcome. And that is a good thing, and it's part of what makes the nerd topic so cool. The next one is constant engagement. This was kind of mentioned with the negative feedback, that positive feedback loop that spiraled down. They went back to video games because it never let them down. Why did video games never let them down? Well, they're fun. Why are they fun? Lots of fun music, great visuals. You're on a challenge all the way. From the tutorial all the way to beating the final boss, you are engaged. You are enjoying it. It's part of your process. It's fun from start to finish. That is a good thing. Compare that to like piano. The research thinks 60 to 80% of people quit piano within the first 2 years. Why? Because it's fun to master. It's fun to be able to sit down and play a song, hear one on the radio, and go. It's hard to get there. I'm one of the 60 to 80% that quit right away. Why? Because it wasn't fun to practice. But these nerd concepts absolutely were. Another one is an outlet for creativity. With these parts, people get to interact in different ways, and it could be like artistically, but also strategically. You can create art your own way, drawing, mobile design, anything like that. That's one form. But also, when you're playing the card game, you pick your characters, you pick your cards, you design it your way. And it's an outlet for that creativity where every single person can do it creatively. Once you have the video game, you build your character a different way for what suits you. It's an outlet for creativity. The last one, and possibly the most important, it lets them fit in at the same time as they stand out. When you're fitting in, you are with a group of people that are in it with you. Belongingness, right? That's the belongingness hypothesis. The negative was because they were socially awkward, right? But here, they get to fit in. Suppose you're playing World of Warcraft. It's an online game. You get a bunch of friends, you get a party, you go on quests. But you also get to stand out. Every single person on the team has a specific role. This person's the healer. This person's the tank. They have a role that they get to partake in, and they get to shine. When it's their job to partake in their role, they get to do it. They're fitting in and standing out. Contrast that with maybe being on a football team. A couple people get to stand out, most of them do not. A handful of people get the limelight, the others fade to obscurity. Here, every single person fits in and gets to stand out. These are some of the things that draw people into this nerd culture, and it's what keeps them there. Those are positive things. They had negative stereotypes because some people took them too far. But like anything in life, enjoyed in moderation, these are positive, and they are cool. I'd like to share some of my own personal things that I like about nerds. I've mentioned a lot about video games, card games, and board games in my talk. I'd like to change gears a little bit and talk about anime, because I think it's an important part of the culture as well, and why I as an individual enjoy anime more than typical Western media. The first thing is it has a very wide range. A lot of people think that anime is the genre. It's more like an umbrella genre. Has every other genre inside of it as well. It has thrillers, and romance, and fantasy, and sports, and battle. Has all of them. You can find anything you want inside of the genre of anime. Do you like cooking? Watch Food Wars. Do you like romance? Watch Anohana. There are examples there where you can find whatever it is that you like based on your genre, and you don't have to take the genre as a whole, but you can still find things you like. Personally, I like the genre as a whole, and I like that it has a wide range because I can try lots of new things. Also, it has character philosophy. Typical Western media is based on events. This happened, here's what has to be done about it. A lot of the popular movies go that way. Whereas with anime, it's based on character philosophy. The main characters have ideals. When there are battles with villains, it's a clash of ideals. They aren't so much just seeing what happens, but it says, here's what our main character believes, here's what the villain believes, and what's happening when we put them together. It's a clash of ideals. That is really cool. An example of that, a recent movie, Infinity War, by Marvel's Avengers. Right? The main villain was Thanos. Right? He stood out as a Marvel villain as one of the biggest and baddest and best villains. Why? He had an ideology. His belief was if he wiped out half of life in the universe, the other half could live a better life. He wanted better things for those people. How he got there was bad. It was an ideology. The main characters couldn't stand for that. A class of ideologies made him a good villain. That movie stood out in Western culture. That's a staple in anime. Almost every single anime does that. I love that about it. You can find characters with those beliefs. Lastly, and possibly the most important, I love their message. Especially from when I was a young child, the messages that anime sent me are almost entirely positive. The first and foremost amongst them, never give up. Mada mada, not yet. It's a refrain. It pops up again and again and again and again, and it's sunk into my soul. I had characters that I grew up watching. I was growing on my journey with them. As they grew, I grew, and they refused to give up until they reached the goal. I am going to work and work and work until people have to accept me for who I am and what I've done. And until I get that, I'm going to keep working. That is missing in Western culture. That it's okay to work hard to get good at what you want to do. It's almost become rare. Watch a children's show. You're not going to see that much, if at all. Never, ever give up. The second moral that I really like that's in a lot of anime is the idea of building a bond. The main characters build bonds with each other. They clash ideals with the villains, and they still have a form of a bond. Once the ideals have clashed, they understand each other. Sometimes they can reconcile them. Sometimes they go their separate ways, but they understand each other. And sometimes they can interact positively later down the road because it was about ideals. Not just good guy, bad guy. We believe this. They believe this. What happens when we collide and have that clash of ideals? Then you get the positive messages. A standard protagonist is going to believe that we should work together. There's lots of examples of these two things. Never giving up and building a bond. Pokemon, intro to theme song. I want to be the very best like no one ever was. That's cool. That's a dream. That's amazing. I look at shows like Naruto. His nindo, his phrase, his ninja way goes, never give up and I never go back on my word. I never give up and I never go back on my word. That is awesome. The will of fire it talks about, something a teacher passes down to a student. It's the belief that love is the only way to reconcile our differences. Right? Love is the path to peace. We can overcome our obstacles if we understand each other, set things aside and do it. And there's examples upon examples of that in anime, and I think it's so cool, and it affected me growing up. I'm more accepting of people, and I want to work hard to be the best that I can. Those grew up with me as a child. Now I watch more advanced anime with more advanced ideals. That's true. But those ones sit deep in my heart because I enjoyed them as I did them. It was so wonderful for me to have that experience. So as I leave you today with this talk, there's a couple things I would like to say. First, nerd culture is rising, and it's rising for a reason. Because it's cool and it's fun. Look at those reasons. It accepts everybody. It's for all people. Low floor, high ceiling, things like that. Anyone can be involved. It's rising. I think it's going to continue rising because it is cool and it is fun. Second thing, if you get an opportunity, there's probably somebody in your life that you would classify as a nerd. Brother, sister, child, cousin, coworker, please reach out to them, ask them about their experience, and have them tell you their story. You probably walked into this believing that nerd was a negative word. They've claimed it and they've enjoyed it, and the whole world seems to think that it's a negative thing that they chose, but they love it. What's it like? Why do they like it? Is there something that they think you would like? You just might make their day, and they just might make yours having that conversation. Keep an open mind and try something new. If you have children that play video games, sit down and play with them sometime. I watched my dad play Call of Duty. It was amazing. It was funny. Right? Things like that. Maybe play a card game with them. If you don't want to try anything new, you probably have some sort of streaming service. All the popular ones have anime. Hulu, Netflix, Amazon Prime, they're on there. Just look them up. Look at one that you might like. Do you like sports? Look up popular sports anime and then pick a sport that you like. Keep an open mind. And finally, let's go with the words of Bill Gates. Be nice to nerds. There's a good chance you'll end up working for one someday. Thank you very much.